thank you for inviting me. Thanks to the house and the mentors of this place for allowing me to speak and share this study. I would consider a lecture because as we have to study a lot, right, to come up with something, I try to make this one as friendly as possible to a study. So the slides will contain pretty much all that I'm saying. If you don't understand what I'm saying, just read the slides and you'll be fine. But truth is, I was invited to talk about storm. I had no idea before, why am I going to talk about storm? And I remember the Adriano, the founder, one of the founders and coordinators of our center, he said, and he just like braced through the books and he chose one, and it was Joanna De Angelis, and the title was After the Storm. I'm like, really? How odd is that? Okay, I guess I have to talk about After the Storm then. So I only got that passage. After the storm has passed, the gift of peace comes. And isn't that right? Because in life, when we are going through struggles, and even when we literally look outside and we see a storm coming, we know it's going to be a heavy one. We see the sky being very dark. I'm like, uh-oh, it's going to rain hard. And we're all afraid of the lightning and thunder, right? Especially the sound. We run away because we don't want to hear the sound. And if we see the lightning, we know the sound is coming. We know we don't die by the sound, but it's not about the lightning. The lightning we can take, but it's the sound that comes after it that is scary. So before we start, I just want to show that even though this is somewhat a lecture, it's a study, but it's a study that goes through my eyes of interpretation. We bring the gospel to analysis and through the also focus of Spiritism. But it still has my coloring. Well, I chose the yellow anyway. But it has my coloring of interpretation. So grasp what you can, and if there's something that you don't think it's right, it's okay to, because it's still an interpretation of the text. That's what we do. We interpret the messages that are being given to us. Now, we are going to watch a video. And I don't know, are we ready for the video? Okay. Because we're going to analyze the passage from Luke, and that talks about that storm that came while they were crossing the lake with Jesus and the apostles.
One day, Jesus got into a boat with his disciples and said to them, "Let us go across to the other side of the lake." And as they were sailing, he fell asleep.
Where is your faith?
where is your faith, was the question. Jesus said, man of little faith. At no moment we saw Jesus being desperate in the storm. As we see the main slide showed with the message from John and Angelis, that after every storm passes comes the calmness, right? But before we continue, we need to define what faith is, right? If we look, faith, by definition, is a firm belief in something for which there's no proof, that does not rest on material evidence. It's a complete trust. So we have complete trust. So we're going to read here. Maybe we can do it together. Just the Luke's passage from chapter 8, verses 22 through 25. Do we have a volunteer, please?
One day, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let's cross to the other side of the lake." So they got into a boat and started out.
Next.
As they sailed across, Jesus settled down for a nap. But soon a fierce storm came down on the lake. The boat was filling with water, and they were in real danger.
Someone else, please.
The disciples went and woke him up, shouting, "Master, Master, we're going to drown." When Jesus woke up, he rebuked the wind and the raging waves. Suddenly the storm stopped and all was calm.
Thank you. Rebuked. So he sent it away. So that's him.
Then he asked them, "What is your faith?" The disciples were terrified and amazed. "Who is this man?" they asked each other. "When he gives a command, even the wind and waves obey him."
Beautiful, huh?
Wow.
So let's analyze. So we know what the parable, this story is about, right? So let's define, what is a parable? A simple story illustrating a moral or religious lesson. So there is a moral lesson behind a parable. So we know what a parable is. So analyze a parable, a story, because we know Jesus always took the opportunity to teach us something, to show us something. For every story, analogy or lesson taught by Jesus, there's always a hidden message waiting to be unveiled. We hear that word a lot, right? To unveil the truth. So the gospel is full of parables. And remember, we're analyzing piece by piece here so we can get to the idea. What is the purpose of the gospel? Isn't it to teach us how to live? In introduction of the gospel according to Spiritism, it is said it's a code of conduct, a safe code of conduct for our public and private life. If Jesus is the truth, the way, the life, he said, those will be saved who follow me. So tune in, those with ears to hear and eyes to see me now and hear my voice. He said, those who are ready to understand the message that I'm giving to you, please hear my voice, hear what I'm saying, what I'm telling you. And in this case, through a story. So those messages, hidden messages, which help us understand the reality of our spiritual life through the moral teachings they contain. So the whole purpose of the gospel is teaching. And here's where I ask you to pay attention. If you are to grasp anything from this study, grasp and take this with you home. Because the whole purpose of the gospel is teaching us how the real life works, the spiritual life of immortality. We learn the virtues and how to apply them in our lives, and that's what we call salvation. Because when Peter and whoever else was in that boat screaming, "Jesus, help, we're gonna die," he's asking to be saved. In this case, the boat can drown, the boat can sink. So they're asking for help. So that's the salvation we are talking about, where we use Jesus' teachings, his virtues in our lives, applying and changing our ways. Excuse me. And as the firefighter who got angels around him, we will always get help when we scream for help. We always get help from the good spirits when we purpose ourselves in doing good and being good. So not just when we're drowning, it's not just when the boat's going to sink. When we ask for help, we get help. And blah, 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 starting over. And when we are doing good, they also come to assist. Because as we do good, we attract good and enlightened spirits. Therefore, pushing away those who don't vibrate in the same level as we do, right, in that moment. So we get help just by doing good. Now, we're going to analyze. So we went over, learned, or got reminded of what faith is, what a parable is, the hidden messages that exist in a parable, the teachings of the gospel. And the gospel is here basically to teach us how to live our lives, conduct our lives. And that confirmation is in the gospel according to Spiritism, the introduction. So let's go on each phrase. One day Jesus said to his disciples. So Jesus is always saying something. He loses no opportunity to teach us something. He is always guiding us to new places to do good deeds. He said, one day Jesus said to his disciples, what did he say? Let's cross to the other side of the lake. We're going to analyze again. So he's always telling us something. Remember, when we are ready to hear his voice, hear his teachings, we start grasping the messages behind it. It's not just the fact that, oh, there was a storm and he calmed the storm. We need to bring that to our lives. Let's cross to the other side of the lake. So they got into a boat and started out. So when we open our hearts to his calling, we are guided to new venues, new adventures, and superior purposes to teach, to learn, and to share. And isn't that true? When we hear, he's inviting us, right? His calling. Let's go to the other side of the lake. This side is no good anymore. Let's go to the other side. Let's do something different now. Let's change our ways. I'm inviting you. I'm calling you. You have ears to hear? Hear my voice. They were going to the other side of the lake to share the good news and teachings with those who have ears to hear him. So now he is sharing the new knowledge, the disciples and him going to the other side, but it's an invitation, it's not an obligation. And no moment he said, I will drive the boat, he didn't. And no moment did he say he would be in control. It was an invitation to get to the other side, but we are the ones driving our own boats. And what is our boat? It's our life, how we conduct our lives. You say, hey, let's go to the other side of the lake. Let's share the good news. I'm inviting you, I'm calling you to come with me. You didn't say, I'll get you there, I give you a ride. No, you are driving it, I'm catching a ride with you. I'll be in your boat with you. He's our north, showing us the way where we need to go. But we are the ones navigating the vessel. Aren't we in control of our own lives? We have decisions to make, for good or for bad. And knowing that we are not alone, that he will always be a passenger in our hearts, guiding us to that new journey. The new journey, crossing the lake. Come to the other side. It's a new place. Giving us, therefore, the free will to choose. It doesn't mean that because he is calling that we're going to answer, right? And we learned that through reincarnations, that we haven't been listening too much to his calling. And then they say, you know what? Go back and do it again. You can do better this time. Or you did this part good, but you can improve this other part. Go back. And I usually make an analogy of a washing machine. People, look, if you don't understand, we all live, New York is here, so, or New Jersey, right? But if you don't understand reincarnation, you do understand washing machine, because we need to do our laundry, right? So it's the washing cycle. Reincarnation is like the washing cycle. You have to throw in your dirty clothes, and it needs to get beat up by storms daily. Daily, and as it does, we start to clean our dirt, wash it off. That's reincarnation. When we take out the clothes, what is it? It's clean, right? So we go through the washing cycles of our reincarnation. And continue on, as they sailed across, Jesus settled down for a nap. Wait, you're a passenger. You're going to guide me and you go to sleep? So agreeing to do good does not mean paradise. Jesus only trusts us with tasks we are capable of doing. He once again will sail for us, but he will always be with us when the storm comes. He knows when the storm is coming. He knows. It's part of our lives. In a different way of seeing life, and I learned that a little bit from my father. My father always says, he likes to joke a lot. So when you say, oh, after the storm comes the calmness, is that after the storm comes another. But that's true. That's a positive way of seeing life, because the storm is what is going to make us stronger, right? And we're going to see that a little bit now. So Jesus knows there's no sailing without storm. So it's like, well, I invited you, you had your calling, you came, I'm riding with you, I'm just a passenger. And you know what? I'll let you drive your boat. You have the free will, I invited you, now let's see what you do. And we remind ourselves that he didn't have an easy path, right? He came as a mission, but it was a stormy path. So we know that we gain experience in life when we deal with issues, right? So if you haven't grasped what I try doing with the coloring, I usually put the ones in the same color for the same meaning. So we gain experience with practice. So when I do the study, for me, it's easier to grasp the idea from the study. So a stormy path is no paradise. We gain experience with practice. So that's basically the idea. And with little faith, we ask for help in desperate times. With real faith, we ask for courage and support to withstand any wind, any waves. Right? So when we have little faith, as Peter was shouting in the boat, Master, Master, we're going to die. Help, save me. Because he didn't trust. Jesus was sleeping. And nobody, like, we saw him woke up, like, what time is it? Like, right? And it's like, let's calm the storms in our hearts, right? So we are here trying to build our boats stronger to sustain the forces around us, which we do not control. So can we say for sure that we control the storms inside of us, in our lives? Can you imagine the storms around us? That son or daughter that don't obey, that mistreat us, or we don't get along with our parents or siblings, and so on. At work, with friends. In the spirit, no spirit center, we all get along, right? There's no problem over here. We're actually very cheerful when we are with one another. Sometimes we want to hug each other, right? Sometimes we want to give them a kiss, a close one, right? But we have to hold on and be gentle with each other. But we know we have struggles, so we have those storms inside of us. So we are trying to build through reincarnation and through the storms that go in our lives. We're trying to be stronger. And the forces we do not control are the ones that are outside of us. I'm here. You could be somewhere else, right? Watching a game, having a drink, or whatever that might be. But we are here because we're starting to hear Jesus' voice, His calling, and we want to change. And we want to learn how to sustain our forces, right? Sustain our boat. Excuse me, because the waves will come, right? The wind will come. And those outside of us, we do not control. But it might be a stormy way, because we do face those in our lives, and someone will say, we are a kid, and we say, look, a dark cloud. It's a huge storm. Oh, it's going to be ugly. It's going to rain. And the other kid is very positive. He looks like, oh, I see the rainbow right behind it. Because that's Jesus looking at us, seeing the rainbow, the Christ that we are in the future. He's not seeing the storm right now. He knows who we're going to be. So He takes a nap. He lets us reach the other side of the lake. So we are here to learn how to control ourselves. We cannot control the weather, the thunderstorm, and heavy rain from others. But we can control the storm inside us. Are we starting to grasp the idea about the parable bringing that to our lives? We are full of storms. We are full of struggle. In family, at work, everywhere. We are being given storms. And there is a purpose for those storms. With time, we understand why the storms come, and why they pass. Like Jesus, we will learn to be calm. You'll learn to take a nap in the boat too. Now, continuing on, but soon a fierce storm came down on the lake. The boat was filling with water, and they were in real danger. That sounds better this way, right? So the storm will always come. But how strong will we reinforce our boat to withstand the big waves and the loud sound of thunder? So what are we doing? Because he's saying, a storm is coming, but it always comes. We all think that our storms are worse than others, right? Our cross is bigger. It's challenging to be ready and to prepare for the bad weather in our lives. But what does not kill us makes us stronger. Isn't that the saying out there? What does not kill us will make us stronger.
There's a song.
Right? I don't know that one. In an analogy, the sword being made by the blacksmith needs to tolerate the beating and the fierce fire before becoming sharp and shiny. In order for us not to be that raw, the rock, the stone, we need to get beat up to find the little piece of diamond that we are, right? Isn't that how it works? It's hard to find the diamond, but it's in there. It's hidden. They lapidate. They beat up just like the sword. and this is the one that I like. To become good drivers, we need to take the interstate. What's more fearsome than taking the highway for the first time after you pass your driving exam? Isn't it true? We are so eager here, being 16, in Brazil being 18, maybe, I don't know what it is, if it's already 16, but in any way, we're so eager to get the driver's license. And we go through school, we do all that, and we think we're good, right? We're driving the secondary roads, there's no traffic, everything is easy. And then when we're really ready and we need to take the interstate, we're like, oh my God, Jesus, save me, save me. We are afraid, there's a truck, there's a bus, we don't know what to do. And that's us. To become good sailors, we need to face the storms. Because in calm waters, everyone is a good sailor, right? Hey, if I put a boat on the pool and everything's calm, I'll be like, oh, I'm great, right? That's pretty much it. So when the storm comes, that's how we really show we can navigate. Same thing goes with the car. So we should not get desperate and bail out the boat. The boat is our life. And to bail out is to give up. Never give in to the storm and give up your life. Ask for courage, ask for assistance, but don't ask for the passing of the storm. We are gaining experience with every storm. We are gaining experience with every storm. In desperate moments, little faith, Jesus, help, take me out of here, right? Instead of, Jesus, give me the courage to sustain this. I know it will pass. I just don't understand why this is happening to me, but it's for my own good. I can know for sure because God is merciful, is sovereign, just, and loving God. So anything that's happening to me is for my own good because He loves me. A father with a hungry son wouldn't give him rock, would give him bread. So He will give us the opportunity to get better. And next, the disciples went and woke Him up, shouting, Master, Master, we're going to drown. Nobody drowns. We only drown if we give up. Have faith. He said, man of little faith, where is your faith? We're not going to drown. A father will not give us a load that we cannot carry. Right? We have kids or nephew, nieces, and we deal with kids. We give them the heaviest of the load. No, we say, carry this one. You can take this one. And we carry the heavier loads, right? That's what we do. Why would a father give, you know, an Empire State Building for us to carry? It doesn't happen that way. So we need to trust more. There are plenty of desperate moments in our lives. We lose our job, a loved one, our friends. We get ill, and we forget we have faith to sustain our difficulties. So that's what this is about. Trusting God, having faith, using the teachings of the Master, understanding the storm will come, and we have to get ready. And believe it or not, we all ask for this. It's no surprise for us. We ask to go through those struggles to get stronger, to get better. We all washing machines here. So Jesus will never abandon us. He will never give us heavy laden we cannot carry. He said, come to me, those who are tired and carrying too much, and I will give you rest. Because I'm humble, I'm calm. I can give you what you need to conduct your life in an easier way, trusting God. And when things are hard, praying, asking for help. And the help comes through that coworker that asks, do you need any help? You are sad today, what's going on? Or a friend who calls and says, oh, I miss you. Long time no speak. And that's the call that we wanted to hear. Like, oh, somebody really misses me. And I'm struggling with my own family. So those are the moments that the help is sent. Sometimes it's a check that you don't expect from the IRS coming to your door. And you're like, whoa, I was in debt and then all of a sudden this money came. Where did it come from? But then again comes another storm and they send another letter next month asking you that you owe this amount of money. It has happened to me. He never said he would carry for us, but he would give us the strength to continue and the will to stand up and keep walking. Stand up and keep walking. If we have time, we have a little video at the end. Hopefully we can go over and see that meaning. He said, take up your cross and follow me. He said, let's go to the other side of the lake. I'm the passenger, you're driving your boat. He never said, we'll carry the cross. He said, take up your cross and come with me. When Jesus woke up, he sent the wind and the raging waves away, right? He rebuked. He will always answer to our calling, even with little faith. And as I was reading this part, another insight came and was like, wow. So he woke up to assist because we were screaming, help, help. But then I start seeing in a different way. I start seeing that he went to take a nap. I'm leading my life. And the storms come. And when the storms come, all of a sudden, I awaken the Christ inside of me. He comes out to calm the storm. It's when I reconnect with the divine and I say, wait a minute, this will pass. This will make me stronger. This will not kill me. Sometimes I look at other people and I say, oh, it's easy for them. You know, they don't have to deal with my son who is an addict. They don't have to deal with a father who I don't know who he is. He wasn't abandoned, and they didn't have to go through struggles. They didn't lose a job. And as Chico gave an example, he said he would go to the center to help people because that would make him forget about his own struggles. And sometimes people say, oh, when I see other people's struggles, other people's storms, I think of mine this big, not this big anymore. I see in a different way nowadays. I see it's not that it makes my problem smaller, but I embrace my cross with so much love now. Because I look at somebody else's cross and like, uh-oh, I cannot carry that heavy load. I like my cross better. Because a lot of people are inspiring us. We see other people with struggles and people that actually lost loved ones. They're mothers who lost all their kids in accidents or in illness. And so there are a lot of bad things happening to people and we're not dealing with those. And we're like, walk away, right? Let me take my little cross with me. It's enough for me to carry. I don't want the others. So despite our lack of faith, during the storm, Jesus always comes. Only he can provide what's needed to alleviate our desperation. And we get desperate. There are moments that we are desperate. We don't know what to do. And then all of a sudden we called this one person. And the person said, don't worry. It's going to be okay. And so a lot of times the next day is okay. And we were so worried. We saw the storm and like Joaquin. And we're like, it's approaching. Bye, Joaquin. He goes somewhere else, right? I remember with Ebola, some people in different parts of the country that I spoke to, they didn't want to leave the house. Excuse me. They were so afraid. Like, no, the town is desert. It's like a desert right now. There's no more water in the supermarket. Everybody's afraid of going out and drinking tap water. I'm like, what? We're in New York going to Central Park and we're drinking tap water from the restaurant. We're just living our lives. We're like, but those are the storms that we're so afraid of going through. But the more we prepare ourselves, not thinking negative, but positive, because after that storm comes the calmness, comes the rainbow, as we saw in the picture in the beginning. So nothing happens without his permission. Why do we shout we are drowning? Why do we think we are left alone? We are not alone. He will always come. We tend to scream out loud, our pains are the worst and we can't take it anymore. And as we just spoke about, but the storm comes to all of us, so we all suffer. Is my cross different from the one next to me? It's a cross the other person has to carry too. It's struggles and storms the other person needs to deal with. In the spiritual center, I'm trying to sneeze. In the center too, we have to deal with it, right? We have conflicts. Because others are human beings too, trying to progress as well, like us. So when we don't understand the suffering and lessons behind each one, we continue to suffer. And it is said that suffering is attachment. When I don't learn to let go. What about the obsessors? Attachment. They haven't learned how to say goodbye. Were struggles from the past, but they didn't let go. So they are still attached to us, things that we did in the past. So everything is about attachment. So we only suffer because we do not accept God's will. We want it our way. No, I'm not going because there's a storm coming. I'm staying put. Oh, wait, there's another storm coming. You go ahead, I'll stay with my boat. We're trying to avoid. And isn't that what a lot of people do when they go to an isolated island? They don't want to deal with society because they're going to suffer. They don't want to go into a relationship because they are afraid of suffering. So afraid of suffering, the fear of suffering, will enable or disable us. And we read this before and we heard this before. God doesn't want the death of his sons and daughters. He wants the death of evil and despair. Despair, lack of trust, lack of faith. Death of evil. The evil that we carry. The indifference, right? Lack of love. Lack of tolerance. As we grow ourselves into better individuals, as we bring, remember the gospel, the virtues to our lives, that's how the evil is going to die. So he's not trying to kill us. He's trying to give us the chance to be better. And continuing on, suddenly the storm stopped and all was calm. As we awaken Jesus inside of us, he who trusts him will never smash against the rocks. Right? We're driving our boats and I'm afraid because a couple miles away I see rocks and I see another boat approaching. But we trust him, he's not going to smash us against the rock. We always get help. Jesus will always come when we need. So when we realize we didn't succumb to the winds and waves, we gain trust again. And isn't that true? We struggle in life. There's something bothering us. And whatever that case might be, and you can imagine in your own minds. And all of a sudden, it passes. That storm passes. And we look back and like, I'm a survivor. Yeah, right? We look in a different way and we say, wow, I actually made it. I made it. So we trust again, like, and we trust ourselves. And that's what we do, right? Like Rocky, right? We have time to analyze and find ourselves in good waters again. So like there's a storm and there's that calmness in between storms, but there's that calmness. And we're like, yeah, I made it. I did it. I went to the other side. So when we trust him, we are not a boat without a map. We are not a vessel without a compass. Remember, as we said, he is our north. So let's be a little bit pessimist, right? And then we convert to, transform into optimist. It says, when we lose our map or our compass, we can still follow the stars. Isn't how they used to navigate a long time ago? There wasn't any GPS, right? Used to look at the stars. So even when things are going in not my way, there's another way that I can take, another path. Excuse me. And even when there's no stars, the sky is cloudy and the storm is strong, we can still follow the current and where the waves take us. So those are, when we saw in the beginning, things that we do not control. There are things surrounding us that we do not control. So if your boss fires you, what are you going to do about it? Is there anything you can do? You got fired. The only thing you can do is try to go back to that job. However, you're going to convince him, for whatever reason he fired you, or look for a new job, right? That's our free will to choose. But it's beyond our control. I'm not my boss, right, in that sense. I got fired. Well, if I lose a relative, right, in a sense of discarded, right, a loved one, is it my control? It's not under my control. So what can I do about it, right? So when I cannot do much, I trust God. Have faith. God wants the best for me. You know, I'll go with the current. What am I going to do? And wait. At some point, the storm is going to pass, and life's going to present itself with an opportunity for me to make a choice. So I'll wait for that choice then. Right now, I'm in debt. I don't have money. I don't have a job. All of a sudden, I'll wait for it. Okay, I send my resumes here and there. I continue looking for interviews. And is there anything else I can do? I'm not going to rob a bank, right? That's not a solution for me. So I'll wait. I'm doing my best. All of a sudden, an opportunity shows up. And now I take my chance. I'm like, there's a job. It doesn't matter. If I'm willing to, if I was a teacher, now I'm going to work as in the restaurant, or I'm going to be a driver. Opportunity show up. It's up to us to decide what to do with it. There's always time when we realize we are not in control. So we accept our fate. That's when we let God's current take us. With calmness. And that's what we're trying to do, control ourselves. And we're not that special so that we must not suffer. Remember, Jesus was special, and he got crucified. So everyone has a cross to carry. As the more we understand this, the better it is for us to go through the struggles, right? Through the storms. Like, it will pass. It will work out. Continuing on, then he asked them, where is your faith? We wake up of the nightmare and realize every storm passes. That's when we gain that trust again. We're like, wow, I survived this. It passed. Like others, a lot of times we don't listen to our parents, right? Mother, father, maybe grandmother, grandfather is like, don't worry, it's going to be okay. We're a teenager. We fell in love for the first time. Like, oh, Jesus, save me, right? We're desperate. And it's like, don't worry, it's going to be okay. I'm like, no, I don't have more hair. So I move my hair, I can't take it. She left me. And then later, like, we look back and like, that was easy, right? He was right. After the heaviness of our afflictions and despair, we notice we lack faith. And that's when we get desperate and we scream for Jesus. Jesus, help me. We get desperate. Our faith is still... it's not steady, which is okay, but Jesus understands that. Without issues clouding our judgment, we verify we were not without divine assistance. We are not without divine assistance. We have help. We have many loved ones, many spirits rooting for us. Well, we have others all rooting against us, right? Because there's always a competition somewhere. But we have divine assistance. Now, ashamed and surprised, we realize we lost faith, just like them in the boat. They're like, wow. Okay, I'm the back of the boat, like hiding. And Jesus probably pointed, oh, you there, hiding. Now, ashamed and surprised, we realize we lost faith, not just faith in the divine providence, but also faith in ourselves, where we struggle to trust. That lack of trust in ourselves, right? We're like, I won't be able to make it. I can't take it anymore. It's part of our spiritual growth. It's part of our nature to learn through pain and not through advice. To learn through lightning and thunder, as we said at the beginning. don't go as a kid, right? Don't climb that chair, you're gonna hurt yourself. Boom. Right? We gave advice, but we don't listen. We need to feel how hard the floor is. And then we're like scratching and sobbing and look back and like, but then we forget we do it again, right? That's us in reincarnation. But yeah, how many times we got advices from our parents and we didn't listen? We didn't listen. Later on, I'm like, yeah, they were right. I should have listened. Well, that's what it is. We learn through pain. We need to bump our heads. We are apprentices of life, and it's okay to make mistakes as long as we learn from them. A kid learns from how to ride a bike after falling many times. I don't know if all of you can ride a bike, but I remember how many times I fell. So I fell down many times, got bruised up and many scratches, but yeah, I was smiling, I was still riding it. But that's what it is. We have to go through to make us better. Take the interstate to become better drivers. And as the last part, the disciples were terrified and amazed. Who is this man? They asked each other. When he gives a command, even the wind and waves obey him. Excuse me. We trust, we have faith, and he calms our stormy hearts. So when we trust, when we have that trust in Christ in our hearts, in our vessels, in our lives, we take control of our boats and we say, the storm can be outside, but I'm still seeing the nice weather. I'm still having a nice weather inside me. I'm still driving my boat the best I can drive. And he is with me. And the more I trust him, the better it is for me. The more I learn the virtues and apply in my life, it's going to be easier on me. Amazed with a human being capable of calming the winds and waves, sending the storm packing. That's what he did, right? It was such calmness. Like, in this sense, looking a little bit on the Spiritism perspective, the doctrine's perspective, we now know, I'm just throwing this out there, because we need to remember, this is still a story, even though it's something that has happened. We are analyzing in different ways through my perspective and the eyes of Spiritism, the teachings of the gospel, but we know that looking at the physics, right, and the physical world, what Jesus did, we know he had moral to do so. We could imagine that spirits were causing the storm, and he had the moral level to make them stop. We could say he also, who created this planet, had the means to manipulate this, the fluids and make it dissipate or whatever else. So in any case, as we are human beings, we are amazed in looking at the spiritual way now. How can somebody be so calm in a situation that is desperate? How many of you look at somebody around and you are desperate and you look to the side and somebody's just... I remember when we went to the workshop, right, with Sandra. And she was giving an example of that story with the earthquake. And she was saying, some of you might have been there and remember, but she was saying, the husband was so calm. There's an earthquake. And the wife wakes up and she's like, honey, there's an earthquake. There's an earthquake right now. So he's like, are the glasses hitting each other? No, so it's going to be fine. So he's calm. And that's what it is. Some people have that calmness. They can calm any storm. We are desperate. Even with our partners, there are situations where one of us is really desperate. The other one is like, just don't worry, I'll take care of it. You don't have to worry about anything. It's going to be okay. So the disciples didn't understand. How could he, right? How can he be so powerful that others are trying to kill him, others are trying to crucify him, and he's still smiling and forgiving. And here, we still don't trust him enough that he can calm the storm. A lot of times, we don't trust even what we study. A lot of times, we don't trust that, hey, forgive. We are so angry with someone, like, yeah, forgive that. Forget it. I'm not going to forgive. At that moment, we're like, well, listen, if you forgive, you're going to feel better. It's freedom in you. Forget about the other. Yes, you're going to feel better. Like, I'm not ready to forgive. And it happens to us. What a little thing can become a big storm in us. And that's when we don't trust him enough. That we, let me stop and think, what would Jesus do? Right? That phrase, what would Jesus do in that case? What do I need to do to become better? And I'm smashing the microphone, sorry. I'm causing a storm in the waves, and creating waves. So he can make us strong to withstand the winds, the waves, the lightning, and thunderstorms in our hearts. We are in awe when we see we are still here after the storm. So the storm passes, come the calmness and the rainbow. God works in mysterious ways, but at the end, he's always working with us to build our faith so we can work for him. Who was Jesus and so many icons out there who taught us, who gave us examples? And we know through reincarnation, they were not born that way. We're born the same way, created the same way. Loving Father loves them the same way, same level. But they got that way because they build their vessel, welding, layers and layers, being strong to sustain storms, many storms. So Jesus is still unknown to humanity, including us. We're starting to trust him and have faith. But he knows better who we are, what we need, and how far are we from resignation and full trust. And isn't that true? Isn't that something that happens to us? It's like, we know who Jesus is, but do we have Jesus in our life constantly, constantly guiding us? He said, let's cross to the other side of the lake, but you drive your boat. And to make a little funny, when we realize we need to face the storm with faith, it will be a piece of cake. And we feel like we are walking on water with no fear of what is to come. Now, this message is from Maymay, Trust Always, and she talks about this part as well. The dawn shines beyond the night. Today, it is possible the storm crumples your heart, right? Smash, it hurts us, and torments your ideals, goading you with affliction, poking, right? Like with sharp stick. So goading you with afflictions or threatening you with death. Don't forget, however, that tomorrow will be another day. Maymay. So, yeah, we can skip that. Let's go to another thing. As I promised, I'll read over here. It's a very short poem. And some of you might already know at least the core idea behind it. Lord, I always notice you by my side, walking on the beach, your footsteps always next to mine. Lord, I knew I could count on you when the storm came sweeping me away. That time that I needed you most, I saw only my footsteps. You left me astray. Oh, dear child, child of little faith, yes, indeed, I was by your side. But the moments you did not see me, those footsteps were not yours. but mine. I was carrying you dearly close to my heart. When you couldn't walk, you were falling apart. No strength to go on. You almost gave up. I was there for you, helping you to stand up.
You have time.
Okay, great. So, and the last part is a little video, and that talks about that, as we saw in the other slide in this poem. When we fall, who is there to raise, to catch us and raise us up?
Thank you.
music by Casting Crow. As we see, the many times that we fall, and he said, in the midst of the storm, the loud storm, you hear me calling, right? You hear me screaming your name, Jesus, save me, and he will come. I'm just a speckle, right? I'm just a flower fading away. But you're so loving that even when I'm desperate, you come for me. So I thank you for being patient. You guys are gaining a lot of virtues here. Tolerance, patience, kindness. Hopefully, you enjoyed as much as I did doing this study.